Hey guys, I'm Shawn Hammond with PremierGuitar.com. We're here in Chicago at Chicago Music Exchange. David Kalt. David, you're the owner of Chicago Music Exchange, right? You bought it like 5 years ago. Tell us a little bit about the history of it.
Chicago Music Exchange was started in 1990 by Scott Silver, and Scott was crazy for vintage guitars. He'd been buying guitars for a long, long time, and he was very, very on the hunt for vintage everywhere. And he built a store around four blocks from here on Clark Street. And over the years, I bought a bunch of guitars from him, and he became very iconic in the vintage world as one of the pioneers in vintage. And he had big vision. And when he built this store that we're in right now in 2007, he had a real big vision for a lot of quality inventory, all under one roof, large ceilings, chandeliers, couches, and really making it comfortable for the musician when they're shopping for gear, and really taking you outside of what you'd expect of a guitar store. When I bought the shop from Scott in 2010, I really wanted to build on that experience. I really wanted to take that, you know, wow experience and make sure that customers could come and always have the ability to try gear they're not going to be able to find locally, and then be able to supplement that with lots of more affordable inventory in the used market, as well as new inventory from all the top brands like Gibson, Fender, Rickenbacker, Martin, Taylor, etc. We look at our store as a flagship destination. So a lot of people travel through Chicago. A lot of bands travel through Chicago. A lot of tourists travel through Chicago. So we want to build a relationship with you when you're in town, but we're happy to service you when you're back at home. And that's why we spend a lot of time on our online channel, our video, our website, as well as selling on, you know, Amazon, eBay, and Reverb. We really want you to find the gear where you want to buy it. We just want to be able to service you wherever you're most comfortable buying, whether it's in your bathrobe or in our showroom. Since purchasing the store, I've become much a greater appreciation for this Gibson wall behind me. So I like Les Pauls, I like Les Paul Customs, I like Juniors, and I try not to get too attached to any one guitar, and I like to experience them as we buy them and sell them. I get a lot of joy out of putting a used guitar in a customer's hand and letting that cycle of instruments just continue to make music.
All right, cool. Well, thanks, David. We're going to talk to George.
Awesome. You bet.
All right, guys. So this is George. George, you're the shop manager?
I am. I'm store manager here. Yep.
All right. Yep. So we're by the Gibson Wall, which is kind of what you see front and center when you come in. And you
pretty iconic wall. It's kind of the first thing that boom hits you in the face when you walk in is the Les Pauls and SGs.
And you're holding probably the most notable thing that's on the ball right now. Tell us about it.
Yeah, I mean, this is about as notable as you can get. It is a 1952 Gibson Gold Top, which, of course, the historical significance is 1952 is the first year of a Les Paul. And they were only doing Gold Tops in 52, but this was the idea of it all. You know, Telecasters came out first, but this was kind of the rebuttal and the answer to the Telecaster. Gibson knew they had to make their solid body, so this is what came out. And this is a all-original 52. It's got a little bit of wear, but actually pretty decent shape, overall. And, you know, 52s are interesting because... You know, historically, again, it's the first year of a Gibson, which is a big deal. But they're not the most playable guitars. So that's the trapeze. Yeah, it's not the most desired tailpiece. You know, for one thing, it just it all depends how you play. But it certainly gets in the way, right? Yeah. If you kind of like to rest your hand here, and then the intonation wasn't the best on these. So this is also kind of a cool one. There's no binding on it, which very, very few examples of that where you won't see binding on it. So makes it even more unique and rare for this one. So yeah, 1952 Les Paul Gold Top. Generally, when you come into the store, everything's by manufacturer. So for example, here's all the Les Pauls and SGs. And then generally, the higher you get, the older it gets. So a good guy.
I'm out of reach.
Exactly. But you can play anything you want here. That is one rule we have. We let anybody experience any guitar they want. Which is cool. So you're generally, the idea is that when you start lower, you'll get used stuff, and then you kind of move into the new stuff, and then you kind of get up to the kind of the primo vintage stuff. So the experience, I guess, is that, hey, you know, you can, we'll let you take a 52 gold top for a ride and plug it in and you know, play something that, you know, most people are never going to get to play. Then you can play the 52 reissue, you know, then you can play the Epiphone gold top version. You can literally, it's all here. You can kind of go down the row and experience every level of model. Another very very cool and rare piece. It's a 1961 SG, but the you know, the thing that that kind of tricks people out is if you look on the truss rod cover, it says Les Paul. So, you know, quick historical breakdown. Basically, you know, the most famous and iconic guitars in the world are Bursts 58, 59, and 60 Les Pauls, which are the, you know, most expensive guitars to date right now. But back then, they were failures. They weren't very successful guitars when they came out. So basically what happened in 1960, they stopped making Les Pauls, and they wanted to go to something a lot lighter, something a lot slimmer and sleeker, and that's basically how the SG was born. And so 61 is that interesting kind of odd year in Gibson where no Les Pauls were being made, and this was the new Les Paul. It kind of, they eventually changed the name to separate it and turn it into an SG. But this is essentially the first year of a humbucker SG, which, again, if you get that 61 and 62 years, you'll still see Les Paul on the truss rod covers. That technically is the model name. It's a Gibson SG Les Paul.
Are you pretty strict about, like, oh, if we're going to buy something this old and this rare and cool, it's got to be stock with original pickups and original pots even, right, and stuff like that?
Yes and no. I mean, yeah, at the end of the day, to get something that's, you know, 100% stock and 100% original is the best buy you can get, and those are gonna have the most value into collectors. That's the kind of stuff that they're looking out for, totally. And it's becoming harder and harder these days to get something that's truly untouched, even to the solder ever being broken. So it's special. I mean, more so than ever to get. You know, 50s and early 60s guitars that are truly untouched, but those will, of course, hold the most amount of value. And then, let alone it being clean. I mean, that guitar is pretty clean. Besides one ding on the top left there.
Is that you?
Absolutely. That's, yes. I'm probation right now in the store. But with all that said, too, we love buying stuff that has changed parts, just because it then,
character
and their players' pieces. So yeah. It allows, you know, kind of the everyday musician to be able to get a really what would be a really, really expensive guitar, but at half the price because of, you know, whatever, because of a refin or because of changed pots or, you know, pickups. It's always nice to get something with original pickups because that's ultimately what people are going for. But no problem buying stuff with changed parts. Just kind of broadens the range of customers and gives people that wouldn't usually be able to buy that stuff, gives them the opportunity to check it out. So.
All right, George, so now we're looking at the Fender wall, which is even bigger than Gibson wall, right?
Yeah, even bigger. So this is kind of the Fender section where basically, when you walk in and you look directly to your right, you're going to see, you know, every Strat known to man. And essentially, it starts with Strats, and then we do keep all the Fenders together. It goes Strats, then it'll go to Tellys, and then it'll go to, you know, kind of offset Jazzmaster and Jaguar guitars and, you know, everything in between. But yeah, our Strat wall is pretty well known and pretty famous. Again, just for pure selection. Again, just kind of like I was saying with the Gibson wall, same idea where, you know, you basically kind of start at the, in Fender land, we have, we carry every price point. So, I mean, you'll start with from Squires to Mexican-made Fenders, then kind of goes up to the USA-made stuff, and then you get into vintage. So this whole top shelf is going to be all 50s and 60s, all pre-CBS real deal Strats. And, you know, got a couple empty hooks right now because somebody's trying out a bunch. So believe it or not, people actually come here to buy guitars and play guitars. So this is a 1958 all original Strat with a maple neck, and actually have another matching set that we got from an original owner who happened to have two 58s, which was awesome. So we bought them both from him. There's been a video on YouTube for the last like 10 years, and it's called like 100 riffs or like the 100 best rock riffs. And this guy does it, and you know, it's the playing's really good, but it's just one camera sitting on it's one guitar, clean guitar tone, and it's so we saw that video and we're like, okay, we can do this better. Like so we challenged Alex and said, hey, you know, come up with 100 riffs chronologically, but you know, using the right pedals and the right sounds for every song. And this is the guitar that he decided to do it on. And if you've ever seen the video, it's up to about 10 million views right now. And it's incredible. It's two or three takes at the most, but it's amazing that everybody thinks that somebody's controlling his pedal board, but that's him. That's him tap dancing and making it all fluid. And it's a really, it's a pretty special video. But this is, if you ever want to hear the tone of a spectacular pre-CBS Strat, watch that video. And this is the guitar. It's a 58 Strat. But this is a great example of the stuff we like to buy, kind of like we were talking about before, like a great player's piece. So here's a 64 Jaguar. So it's still pre-CBS, being that it's before 1965. And it is a refin. So it's a great refin in like kind of an Olympic white. And, you know, here's an original white. So the color is actually is pretty good. It doesn't have the checking, but it's got that really cool kind of yellowish thing that Olympic white, how it ages through the years. So here's a great old refin. And, you know, it's basically, it goes from a guitar that is $4,000 or $5,000 and it cuts it down to $2,500. And what you want on the guitar to be original is original. So the parts are there, the pickups are there, and, you know, it's got original frets that still have a lot of life left in them. The big complaint is always the bridges on these and the saddles. If you even remotely strum or, you get aggressive at all, the strings, I mean, I can pick it up and slide it. I mean, that's what they do. So there's a lot of good replacement bridges out there, like mastery bridges and stuff that's solving these problems. But again, every now and then you get a guitar where they sit perfectly and the tension's perfect and the action's low and this actually intonates perfectly.
So we're back in sort of this little alcove behind the main room, and it's all the hollow body and semi-hollow stuff, right?
Yeah, absolutely. This is my personal favorite section of the store where, this is basically hollow bodies, fully hollow, semi-hollow, arch tops. This section is going to be predominantly vintage for the most part. This whole wall is going to be, you know, really iconic stuff from the as early as the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s. And again, if it has F holes, this is where it's going to live at the Chicago Music Exchange.
So here you've got a 295.
Yeah, this is a cool guitar. This is a 1956 ES-295, and you know, 295s pretty much they're famous for being gold, and you know, basically Scotty Moore, Elvis's, you know, original guitar player. That was his guitar of choice. If you look at old Elvis videos, he's always playing that old gold top ES-295, which really is one of the most famous and important guitars in rock and roll. I mean, all those early Sun Records recordings, that's all Scotty Moore, and he's playing a 295. So this one's cool. It's Sunburst. I've never seen a Sunburst one in my life. I've been working here a long time. There's rumored to be a very small handful, definitely in single digits for Sunburst ones. I've seen Eric Clapton play one here and there, but you know, for the most part, this is the first Sunburst one we've ever gotten in an ES-295. It's not just old, you know, 335s and and 330s and old, you know, kind of high-end Gibsons. We carry a lot of, and again, another kind of iconic Chicago thing is all these old department store guitars that, you know, have gained a lot of popularity over the last couple of years with a lot of the, kind of the garage blues thing happening with the Black Keys and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. So a lot of these companies, they're Chicago companies, so Harmony and Silvertone and K's and again, you know, now these are guitars you got to be careful when you buy them. They always sound cool. That's why people like them. There's nothing else that sounds like them. So you can really stand out and really be creative with these guitars. But again, 9 out of 10 of them, you know, you got to fight them and they don't play well at all. So we always have the opportunity to buy a lot of these, but we are, you know, we're very careful. You know,
pretty selective.
Make sure the truss rod works and it's, you know, it's not just a slide guitar. You know, it's actually playable. So, I love these guitars, and again, and they're still really well priced. I mean, you can still get all these guitars under $1,000, yeah. and just get really, really cool pickups like these that Silvertone. I mean, and the Harmonies, they all have those original D'Armond pickups, which are just kind of all the rage now. Now every new, you know, pickup guy is making their version of a gold foil, right, or a D'Armond. So really, really, really cool guitars, and we always have a really big selection of, again, kind of those department store guitars that were, you know, not worth a lot at all back when they came out.
Now you're gonna know a lot more than I do about this, but like that Harmony Monterey and the Hoyer back there, those are those are ones you don't, that are even more rare to see.
Even more rare, yeah. And those are, you know, those are arch tops. So, you know, yeah, there's not going to be any pickups in those. But it's funny, you, again, back in the kind of the 50s and the early 60s when, you know, guitars are exploding in the United States and you know, you got companies like Harmony and Hoyer and they're making affordable guitars that that anybody can buy out of a catalog. So they made a lot of them. I mean, and they experimented and they made, I mean, you could still go all over the country and go to different guitar stores all over the world and you'll see, you know, I've never seen a Monterey like that before and that kind of finish. And, you know, again, it was just kind of a funky, cool era in building guitars and experimenting. And you could still, you know, still amazed that when any of these style of guitars come in, there's always something like, oh, I've never seen one with red inlays, you know, on the fingerboard. So there's some of the best guitar building in, you know, I think ever is happening right now. You know, vintage guitars are cool and rare and but, you know, sometimes with vintage guitars come vintage problems. Yeah. So if you want kind of the best of the best, you know, really handmade guitars, this is kind of your section. Just some of the brands that we really stand behind include Collins, for both acoustic and electric, but Bill Collins is, you know, making some of the best guitars in the world. Echo Park, Dennis Fano, you know, then, you know, got a big Paul Reed Smith wall here.
We're seeing Nash.
Yeah, I got Nash guitars, which are really popular, kind of for the, you know, kind of getting into something that's Fender custom shop quality, but, you know, half the price. That's what Nash does really well. And
we're seeing Reverend down here, so it's not just high end boutiques.
Yeah, I mean, you know, boutique. I mean, I don't know what does that mean anymore, but I mean, you know, we really stand for quality here. It's everything to us. So and guitars that really stand out. So Reverend, great example, where, to me, kind of the best, you know, thousand and under dollar guitar in the market, and they, you know, they're not doing, you know, the typical Strat and Tele thing like that everybody else does. So these really stand out, and you know, at the end of the day, they're, you know, we're trying to put tools in people's hands that help, that inspire and create.
Are there any brands that you guys are sort of getting hip to, maybe local builders or just something that's sort of flying under the radar right now that you feel like it's going to be a big thing?
To me, Echo Park guitars. Gabriel Curry out of Echo Park, California. One of the only guys, I think, that truly does not use any machines. I mean, he is using old building techniques, and you know, he was apprenticed for Leo Fender, so he learned from the guy when over back at GNL. Literally every millimeter of his guitar is made in the USA. That's really important to him, and you know, that's important to us too. It's pretty cool and special to get something that I mean is made in the USA from the screws to, you know, to the tuners to the pickup. So he is again, he's doing stuff there. You pick up anyone in your hands, and you'll get it. Love Gretsch's here. And, you know, Gretsch is one of those kind of great manufacturers where they have just as much tradition as, you know, Gibson and Fender. But it was always that guitar that was, you know, again, just kind of outside of the box. And even from their motto, that great Gretsch sound, I mean, nothing sounds like a Gretsch, which is great. So this is a really cool example. We rarely get these in. This is a 1955 6121. It's basically like a Gretsch Roundup, which, again, it's got the awesome kind of country western kind of leather tooling on the sides, and then the G brand on the top. And these just always, if you've ever seen one of these in person, they always just age in like the most incredible way. So that's
all stock. Like pickups and
everything. Yeah, the thing that's not stock is it's just some of the hardware, the Bigsby. And again, kind of another cool example of, we get this really great guitar in that is nowhere near as playable as it probably should be. So we made the appropriate changes. We have a great repair shop downstairs that can kind of resurrect guitars like this, and, you know, putting the right hardware and to make it actually playable and not just a wall piece. And this deserves to be played.
George, we're standing in the acoustic room. It's, you know, walls lined just like the rest of the store with lots of nice new and old guitars. You're holding a pretty rare Martin right here.
Yes. This is a Singolo 20, which is going to be a spruce top and then Brazilian rosewood back and sides. And this one, don't have an exact date on it, but it is early 1850s. So, you know, again, this is about as old as you can get. I mean, this is truly a piece of American history. I mean, this is close to, you know, the beginning of Martin. And, you know, the beauty of it is that still plays and sounds fantastic. You know, we do probably more so than electrics, getting back to kind of boutique and really nice American made acoustics, guitars. That's really where this room shines, because I mean, there are really, really great acoustic guitar makers right now. Big Taylor dealer. Love doing business with Taylor. One of those really cool brands where they're not trying to be anybody. They're not. You know, they're not Martin and Gibson and have this big vintage appeal. They're a little bit more of a modern company, even though they've been around for the 70s. But yeah. They make guitars that last forever. And you know, so love having Taylors. They're great to work with. Bedell is one of the new manufacturers we've picked up that we all really love here. So you kind of got your big three of Gibson, Martin, and Taylor, and we carry the full lines of all three. And then
Callings that you mentioned, right?
Stuff, which is really, really just fabulous guitars that are hard to beat, and that includes Callings. Love Callings. We're a huge Callings dealer. Carry the whole line, and if you've never experienced a Callings, I mean, it's as good as it gets. But then you have Santa Cruz. We love carrying those. Huston Dalton. So again, just kind of those handmade, using the finest quality woods, imaginable from luthiers that have been doing this a really long time and know what they're doing.
Very meticulous.
So, absolutely. Every inch of it is, yes, made with love. So, and then Guild, big Guild dealer. Love having Guilds. They, Guilds probably make one of the best, $600-$800 guitars in the planet. So, again, it's not, it's certainly not just high end here. We have every price point. I've been working here about 9 or 10 years, and that's the second or third one we've gotten. Mid 1900s. It's in that ballpark. And of course, one half is a harp and one half is a guitar. I'm still yet to see anybody actually know how to play it and play it well. Well, play the harp side well. That is. And most people are actually are scared to tune it and scared to turn the knobs. But I mean, it's about as cool as a showpiece, a wall piece as you're ever gonna get. Very hard to find these days. Yeah, and that's a very, very early Gibson harp guitar.
All right, so George, so far we've been talking about all the really cool guitars, but you guys have amazing amps here, just like the guitars. You got amazing old vintage stuff, the usual Marshall, Vox, Fender, and all that, but then some really weird shit. Yeah, Evans, I've never even heard of Evans amp right there. I don't even know what that is, yeah. But, you know.
Me neither. But it looked cool, sounded cool, so we're going to buy it. Amps, the other parts of the equation. We love amps here, love vintage amps. We'll carry the usual suspects. Got a great collection of old Marshalls, from some plexis to, kind of all the early 70s cool 1500 watt amps and some really cool custom Tolexes too. We'll always have a good collection of old Marshalls, old Voxes, old Fenders especially. Love having tweed amps around here, like old Champs, and here's a really cool 1948 Deluxe. So this is a really, really old early Deluxe, about as early as it gets. I love carrying everything outside the box again, not just your typical, Marshall, Fender, Vox thing. So we'll do, got like an old Silvertone here, an old Rickenbacker amp, old Gibson amp, which, are all truly, have really magical and unique tones, always real raunchy, dirty tones, but, great for recording and super good in the studio. And there's a lot of great small venues in Chicago, whether it's small blues clubs or small indie clubs. And, these amps are just, they're everywhere in Chicago, which is great. Again, kind of like pedals and guitars, boutique amp builders are, I mean, the best they've ever been. I mean, it's a very flooded market. I mean, that, everybody makes a great amp, and they really do. Everybody makes a cool amp, but so it's hard to pick, what to carry. I mean, we really have to test everything out and make sure everybody's on board. But some of the highlights, Dr. Z, we're a really big Dr. Z dealer. And everything from Victoria Amps, which are a store favorite. There's a Chicago company who, Mark Bear over at Victoria does the absolute best 50s replications of Fender amps. He is a historian, if you ever had a chance to talk to him. Another amp company, too, where every inch of that amp is made in the USA, from the nuts and the bolts to the Tolex to everything. And then, of course, Tone King and Two Rock and kind of the premier Builders Guild, you know, things. And and then some newer amps that we've kind of been really loving are Revival amps. Really simple amps that, you know, the guy used to make satellite amps, which are really great amps, broke off and started making Revival amps, which are based off of, it's just one amp, and it's based off this white amp that came out in the late 50s, which you'll never see, but that's what it's based off of. But it's cool tweed tone. Lewis Electric, another really, you know, great boutique amp that, you know, again, our old, you know, old Fender and Marshall replications, but yeah, with their own taste on it. And then, you know, the usual suspects of Vox and, you know, newer Fender, and carry the full lines of those. So there is, there's nothing but amp selection when you come in here.
You were mentioning earlier that one of the current rarities or unique things is a Park amp modified by Howard Dumble that used to be owned by Ben Harper.
Yeah, Ben Harper, who great customer of the store, great friend of the store, and he's always selling us guitars and trading guitars with us. And he had a Park amp that was basically modified by Dumble. And you know, Dumble, you know, it's this mythological you know, amp that you know.
I didn't want to ask. Well, I do want to ask how much, but. I'm bracing myself.
It's cheap. It's like $30,000. I mean, you know, with Dumble's name associated to it, usually stuff starts at like $100,000. It's two really rare things in one, and it's owned by a really great guitar player and, you know, rock star. So it's that amp is, you'll never find one of them. That is one of a kind. So that's a very cool amp.
Cool. Now we're going to head downstairs because you guys have a really cool bass department too. So
we do. Yes. Bass shop opened a couple years ago, and it's we're very proud of it, and we've got some really cool things down there.
Let's go check it out. All right. So now we're down in the basement in Chicago Music Exchange, talking to Mark. You're the head of the department down here, right?
I am indeed. Yeah.
All right. So you guys have a really nice setup here. You got kind of a lot of the basic mainstream brands, but a lot of really cool boutique stuff and cool vintage stuff like you're holding right here. I guess why don't we just start off with what you're holding here, the Gibson.
Yeah, this is we're dating this between 59 and 61. It's a really cool EBO. I mean, like, the reason we're saying 59, 61 is because of the body style. It's got like that old, like, Les Paul double cut, you know, like the Les Paul Special or Junior double cut sort of look to it. Super, super resonant. But what's really cool about this is not only the sunburst finish here, but on the back of the neck as well. We think this is a one-off for sure. The finish is definitely original. It's a one-piece mahogany body, super resonant, big fat sound. A lot of people have problems with these, like, larger pickups here, like the mudbucker, as it were. For whatever reason, it's just this happens to be a nice, like, bright and punchy one. So yeah, it's just
it's not super growly or anything.
No, not at all. No, it's just got the right kind of sound, and I mean, like, you know, just like hitting an E and just like letting it sustain for days on end. Definitely a really, really unique piece that, you know, I'm just really happy to have. You know, some folk instruments down here as well, just because you know, we just opened this place up last September, and you know, we got some Warwicks. We do a lot with more modern basses and boutique basses, such as Warwicks. We just added a few lines as well from out of the country, such as Sandberg, which they've been doing really, really well for us. Sandberg basses are pretty fantastic, and very happy with how they worked out with us. We of course, you know, have the Gibson stuff. We've got a bunch of Fenders here, and we try to really have a lot to offer when it comes to the Fender basses, both new, used, vintage, just across the board. Coming over this way, we've got like boutique bases such as Exotic, company that, you know, like their home base is actually out of California. They make really, really, really just like nice quality components. They use quality woods. We of course carry Rickenbacker or Rickenbacker, for, you know, you internet trolls out there. We carry Wilson, Wilkins, I'm sorry. You know, he does amazing finish work, Nash basses. Relic jobs do really well here, like Relic guitars. That's why we like to carry Nash. And also, again, back to Sandberg, their relicking is like some of the best in the industry, I think. And like, they really, really, really shine with that. And then basically all of this crap is just stuff that we love, like things that we can really, really stand behind. And like, you know, if we don't like it, it's we try to find a reason to like it or why somebody else would like it. I mean, like, you know, you can't doubt a lot of the quality of the stuff that's in here. So that has to be number one. Even if like the design is not really our speed, it's going to be somebody's as long as it's made really well.
All right, Mark. So this is a jazz bass from
61. So we think that this is a transitional piece. Most 60s and 60, like 61s especially, you'll see the concentric stack knobs. Mm-hmm. And the thing with this one is that, you know, like the electronics work, they check out. The pots date to 61. The pencil date on the neck dates to 61. This bass is just simply, oh, and also like the rosewood slab board. So it's definitely pre-62, pre-63. But we're putting this as a genuine 61. It you know, obviously this tug bar here was moved up here for more like modern playing style. But I mean, either way, the bass has a lot of mojo, man.
Check out that headstock.
Yeah, it's undeniably cool. We think that's probably seen a little bit of moisture, but it just made a really cool friggin' effect to it.
Yeah, it almost looks like figured wood or something, but yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty something else. The neck on this thing is what's really killer, along with like the output of these pickups, just crystal clear, real ballsy sound. I personally like things that have a lot of character to them, a lot of age. Like this just says to me like that there's a lot of history to this bass, and clearly like whoever had this, like they really, really, really loved it. And like if you had it in your hands, you definitely understand. But this is a very, very special bass for sure.
Let's see the back.
Yeah, check that out there. And the neck too is nice and broken in as well. It's something else.
Okay, Mark, before we head out of the bass room, you want to tell us about the amps? Like, you got some cool vintage things here. Like, I've never even seen a Hohner vintage bass amp, but
yeah, that's a cool little weirdo. It's a solid state combo. It just sounds really neat. But I think more importantly is the amp too. It's right. The SB12. Originally, it was designed for upright bass players, like the baby bass back in the day. But personally, I find that, and a lot of people do this too, like with flip tops in general, they just sound incredible in the studio, which is one of the reasons why the amp to the back of it, the B15N. Is something that Ampeg recently came out with again, just to kind of really cover that ground. It's a phenomenal studio amp. It's really, really well built. Definitely an homage to the older stuff. All the B15s we ever get, they're gone immediately, just because everyone knows like they're pretty affordable and they just sound awesome in the studio.
Okay, how about in terms of just new stock you carry? I think I see some Eden over there, maybe.
Yeah, we've got a pretty wide range. We just brought Eden back into the store. You know, they really upped their game over the past couple years. We got TC Electronic in. Their bass stuff is really, really covering a lot of good ground. And as far as the more modern sound, it's high quality stuff, very compact and also very light. You know, the older we get, like, or the older the clientele gets, I just notice more and more that people want lightweight and loud, and the manufacturers are like, well, these dudes have money, so we might as well cater to that demographic and just make it better and better. Got a few local companies, like one of which, Exonix, he builds really great cabs, kind of takes like a fearful kind of a design with like the tweeter and the extra 6-inch speaker and like the three-way versus two-way switch. That's a 212 there, it's super loud. And then most notably, like one of my personal favorites is this company called Dictator. You know, like definitely there's another company that's from Chicago that's been here, you know, for a while. That's not sure what their future is, but Dictator is definitely picking up where they're leaving off as far as that kind of aesthetic, nice, like beautiful wood grain patterns. But most importantly, it's built really well. And that's kind of like the whole mantra of like Emperor, Dictator, and companies like that. They want to build high quality stuff that looks freaking awesome. It's just gorgeous. It's like freaking furniture, and it sounds incredible. They use high end quality components as far as like every detail. So it's you know, made in the U.S. And of course, like Ampeg and Gallien Kruger and stuff, all equally really cool. You know, very important for what they do as far as the bass world. But yeah,
all right, cool. Thanks for talking to us, Mark.
No problem.
All right, guys. So we can't leave the shop without talking about the pedals that line the front here. This really cool case. Yep. Got shelves over there with used stuff. So, mm-hmm. George, tell us about the whole pedal deal going on.
Yeah, you know, kind of going along the themes of what we're talking about with all the great boutique amp makers and all the very boutique guitar builders. There is just a plethora of really great boutique pedal makers out there right now. I mean, pedals are as good as they've ever been. I mean, if you have a sound in your head, I mean, you can get it. You know, so we probably have one of the bigger pedal selections that you will find anywhere. And we sell a lot in the store, sell a lot online. But you know, the beauty is you can come here and because you kind of got to test a pedal out before you buy it. Okay. So you can go into one of our amp rooms and have some privacy and do a pedal shootout. And so we, you know, all the sales guys that work here, they're all total pedal nerd junkies, and they can talk fluently about, you know, everything and anything and get the right, you know, sound and pedal in your head to help you kind of inspire your craft. So, you know, it's just another tool here that we sell that, again, helps guitar players be creative and inspire. So yeah, pedals, big part of our business. We love pedals here. We carry everything under the sun.
All right, so long tour. Hey guys, George, David, want to thank you for having us up here to show us all the stuff. I mean, we just scratched the surface. You guys have all this and more online. Where should people even go to get started lusting after this stuff?
ChicagoMusicExchange.com. One word, one long URL, but lots of gear, and we're waiting for you. Thanks again for coming by.
Sweet. Thanks, David. Thanks, George.
Thank you.
I'm Shawn Hammond for PremierGuitar.com. Thanks for joining us.
Don't forget to sign up for PG Perks, your all-access pass to exclusive gear giveaways and discounts on PremierGuitar.com.